Simon & Schuster Audio presents Buzzsaw, the improbable story of how the Washington Nationals won the World Series by Jesse Dougherty. Read by Angelo Di Loreto. Prologue. The Top. December 10th, 2019. From here, from 30 floors above San Diego, from a room that overlooks the bay, then the ocean, then the edge of the freaking world, Mike Rizzo can see everything. It is what he'd been seeking for decades. This view, a moment of closure, perspective that only comes at the top. And fuck, he says, over and over, about 10 times in 40 minutes. It feels fucking good. Look at this. Look at the bright manicured grass. Look at the boats cutting through the water, forming waves in their wake, forgetting their way for a second, maybe two, for just long enough to enjoy the ride. Look at the sun, but not too hard, because it's busting through the window, bouncing off Rizzo's bald head, bathing everything in this suite, from the white sheets to his black sneakers in yellow light. Look at the top, and now look who made it there. The emotions are still there, Rizzo says, fiddling with his new wedding band, fighting the urge to break down and cry. They always will be. Rizzo can't look around without looking back. The past happened. The past is why sitting on this couch inside the Manchester Grand Hyatt is so sweet. He's on the West Coast for important business. Baseball's annual winter meetings are happening downstairs. Rizzo, the general manager of the Washington Nationals, is constructing a roster for 2020. He has agents to meet. He has phone calls to make. But these days, the 58-year-old often sinks into long bouts of reflection. You'll have to forgive him for that. You'll also have to let him explain. He has never had a December like this. He has never walked through these meetings, a skip in his step, and had each conversation start with the same word, congratulations. Everyone is saying it. It's not getting old. Because they were all watching in October, when the Nationals took their tortured history, the years of playoff heartbreak, and changed, well, everything. The early years rush back and Rizzo leans forward. He was named GM in 2009, a little more than a decade ago, and the first real disappointment came 2 years later. Rizzo wanted to finish 81-81. He wanted it more than anything. But the Nationals had one game canceled, it was not rescheduled, and their final record, when 6 months added up, was 80-81, a win short. Yet Rizzo soon learned that was nothing. He and Washington learned the hard way. His shoulders slump as he tells those stories of 4 seasons that finished in the National League Division Series. They were 1 strike away from advancing in 2012 before Pete Cosma, the Cardinals' light-hitting shortstop, ripped a 2-run single to rip them apart. Their next playoff run in the fall of 2014 crumbled in San Francisco. The run after that in 2016 slipped in Game 5 against the Cubs when Max Scherzer came in from the bullpen and the stadium went sideways. Then came 2017, another great club, another chance, and by the end of it, another mark against faith. That time it was the Dodgers. The common thread was that the Nationals never won. It's terrible. Terrible. Rizzo remembers every time he woke in the first month of the offseason, dazed by defeat, and had to start all over again. Sometimes he didn't even wait that long. In October of 2014, after the Nationals fell to the Giants, Rizzo worked through the flight back to Washington. He opened his laptop, the screen glowing in the dark charter plane, and stared at a list of returning players, of free agent targets, of prospects and other bits of the future. There had to be an answer, he thought, in this web of losses and loose ends. The impossible part was finding it. It's a terrible feeling. Then, all of a sudden, as if a reminder were whispered in his ear, Rizzo is living in 2019. His short, stocky frame, cut like a man who once played baseball, inches to the couch's edge. He acts out the highlights as they burst into his head. Soto's single off Hader in the wild card game. Rendon and Soto hitting back-to-back homers off Kershaw in the NLDS. A sweep of the Cardinals. Two wins against the Astros. Three crushing losses at home. And finally, there he was in Houston. His son to his right, his wife to his left. Their eyes watching a pop fly drop to earth. It wasn't over then. Not yet. But Rizzo turned to his son, to his wife, to himself even, and let a thought escape his mouth. "We're going to win the fucking World Series," Rizzo told them, in the last hours of October 31st, 2019, two outs before the Nationals beat the Astros for their first championship. The Nationals bucked a list of modern trends to do so, blended old and new school tactics, didn't stay away from older players, but built a winner on their backs. They made chemistry a key ingredient. They survived a 19-31 start when their title odds sunk to 1.5%, when it seemed reasonable, if not necessary, to give up and plan for next year. Then they survived five elimination games in the postseason, despite trailing in each one, and became the first to win a title with four road victories. So after a lifetime of waiting, of wondering if the luck would flip, Rizzo could admit to saying those words out loud. They rattled around the empty hotel room in San Diego. He's still wondering how they make any sense at all. 1. They were ready for you. November 28th, 2018. They rode down an alley off reality, beneath the dim yellow streetlights, by bare bushes, bristling trees, and into a dark cul-de-sac, the gravel slicked and messy, the Potomac River swishing up to shore. This was where rich people went to impress other rich people. Right inside, past one set of doors, then another, a pair of lit fireplaces and a wooden wraparound bar. So here were Mike Rizzo and Mark Lerner at Fiola Mare in Georgetown, with millions to spend and business at hand. This, Rizzo believed, was how they'd turn the Washington Nationals from an 82-win team, their final identity of last year, into a real contender. Rizzo was not focused on the free agent everyone was talking about. He instead wanted the top starting pitcher on the market, and wanted him bad. That pitcher had visited two teams before arriving in Washington on November 28, 2018. Rizzo knew others were in the mix. And how to show his interest, yet not come off too desperate, was what the GM had stewed over for days now. He had to nail this dinner. "See, Pat, they were ready for you," Rizzo told Patrick Corbin while they walked through metal detectors in the entryway. Security was wall-to-wall in the Italian restaurant, and Rizzo joked that it was to protect Corbin from adoring fans. Their white-clothed table was set for six. Corbin sat down next to Jen, his wife, and straight across from Rizzo. Lerner, the Nationals' managing principal owner, and John Courtright, Corbin's agent, filled the last two seats. It just so happened that Vice President Mike Pence was dining there too. The dinner crowd is politicians, lobbyists, or anyone who, in a given night, can spend $125 on the cheapest caviar or $500 on the average bottle of wine. Corbin and Jen liked fine dining and had splurged in the past, but this was another level. They were still high school sweethearts from Syracuse, New York, modest and smiled at each other while leafing through the leather-bound 64-page wine list. The most expensive was a 1997 Sangiovese. It cost $10,500. Rizzo told the group that Mr. Lerner was paying. Everyone laughed. Then food and drinks began pouring out of the kitchen, carried by waiters wearing black vests and a rainbow of ties. A seafood tower was topped by a whole lobster. There were plates and plates of caviar. There was wine, endless amounts of it, and the five of them chatted about the menu, the city, and when small talk faded, what the Nationals were all about. It was already shaping into a quiet offseason around baseball. A stalled market revolved around Bryce Harper, Manny Machado, and a list of free agent stars who had yet to sign new deals. The Nationals were linked to Harper because of history. For 9 years, since he was drafted in 2010, Harper was Washington, Washington was Harper, and they both squinted into that mirror image for answers that never came. Harper met the world as the chosen one, posed on the cover.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.